Here you have Ghana as the forefront of the liberation struggle in Africa. What was it like to hear that Mr. Nelson Mandela had passed on?
It was difficult to process at first. I mean, because Mandela is such an icon, you know, one wonders, what's the world going to be like without Mandela? And so it's only this morning I had the opportunity to file pass. And when you really see that the mortal remains are there, then you know that it's a reality that the man is gone. He'll probably go down in history as one of the greatest people in this world, up there with Gandhi and all of them. I mean, this was a phenomenal human being.
You mentioned a few names you've got to mention in this context, Kwame Nkrumah, the father of Ghana. What's the link for you between the two men?
For me, the link is very interesting and it's historic, because Ghana, as the first country, black African country, mm-hmm. to emerge from independence, emerge from colonial domination. And then South Africa, which was one of the most difficult struggles. I mean, the worst form of colonialism was apartheid, you know. And so the first and the last. You know, and the fact that Ghana, once Ghana became independent, we committed our independence to the liberation of the rest of the continent. Like our president said, he said the independence of Ghana is meaningless unless it's linked to the total liberation of the African continent. And so in growing up as young people, I mean, we saw several of the freedom fighters come to Ghana. They were given diplomatic passports as Ghanaians so that they couldn't be arrested in different parts of the world. A lot of the young South Africans and other liberation movements came to school in Ghana, actually. And so there's that intrinsic link between us, and we feel a part of South Africa's history.
I've got to ask you, Mr. President, in that line of talking, you were Minister of Communications. You described in one of your reports that you met Mr. Mandela by chance, didn't
you? Yes. It was a very interesting meeting. It was a chance meeting. As a student, I had participated in manifestations for him. We had gone on demonstrations, held concerts, asking for his freedom and all that. And I became Minister of Communications. He had come out in 1990 and had become president in 1994. And had left the presidency then. This was late 99 into 2000. I came to Cape Town for a conference on communications. At that time, mobile telephony was just, you know, rolling out. And we had gone out for a night on the town, young ministers with a few of my friends. And then I came back to my hotel, which was the Cape Sun Hotel in Cape Town. Mm-hmm. And then I was standing right in front of the lift. I had pressed the button and was waiting for the lift to go up. And then when the lift opened, I mean, there walked out Mr. Mandela. Indeed, I was standing in his way, so I had to move aside for him to pass. And he nodded in my direction. I was so frozen. I mean, I didn't expect it. And so I couldn't even nod back. And he just walked past me. I mean, this was somebody I had idolized for so many years since I was a young person. And he just walked past me. And he was accompanied by two people. He walked into his car and he drove off. I regret that I couldn't hold his hand and shake him and, you know, interact with him.
Let's fast forward a few decades later, Mr. President. President Jacob Zuma recently stepped into Ghana a few weeks or months ago.
Yeah.
Any indication back then on what was the state of Nelson Mandela?
Yes.
Did he come up?
We had a very successful visit when President Zuma came a few weeks, barely 3-4 weeks ago. And I think that it drew our two nations even closer together. Yes, we held discussions, and of course, he said that President Mandela was in a poor way, but I didn't have any indication that, you know, the end was going to come so soon.
Now, there's a special link between the two countries, isn't there? South mm-hmm. Africa, Ghana, both at the forefront of liberating this continent. But the question invariably comes up, what happens next? Does South Africa and Ghana, given their special relationship yeah. that they have, what happens next for these two countries in the fight for economic freedom of the people of this continent?
I think that President Mandela has taken the long walk to freedom, mm-hmm. and he's done his bit. He's at rest. It behoves us, on us, the next generation, to take it up from there. This was a liberation struggle, and with his death, and I mean, with of course, there are a few left, like Kenneth Kaunda, but that is the era of the freedom fighters and those who liberated this continent. I think that the next challenge we face is the economic liberation of the continent. spurring the growth of Africa, creating a decent and dignified life for our people, integrating our economies, making sure that good services and human beings are able to travel freely amongst our countries. I think that is the challenge we face, and we must develop the political will to be able to do that. When President Zuma came to Ghana, it was one of the focal points of our discussions, how we can create a continental free trade area in Africa in order that we can boost the level of trade between us instead of maintaining the new colonial trade links that we currently have.
Mm-hmm. You look at a country like Ghana, second to Nigeria, South Africa trades quite extensively with that country. What's in that relationship that can be taken forward?
Ghana and South Africa are seeing a phenomenal increase in trade and investment between our two countries. There had been an imbalance in favor of South Africa, but that gap is being closed now. There's been an increase to about $500 million dollars in trade between our two countries. I think we can do more. And I think President Zuma's visit to Ghana is going to open up, you know, the relationship between the two even more. He came with about 90 businessmen. Mm-hmm. Already they are critical South African investments in Ghana, in the mining sector. Goldfields is quite active in commerce, ShopRite, Game, all the various South African brands are present. Mm-hmm. And so I think that we can move that level of trade and investment a step higher.
So I mean, it's an obvious question, but does this sad day, but at the same time a day of pride, a week of pride rather, does that have anything emotively to give to or to contribute to relations, you think, not only of South Africa and Ghana, but just generally the spirit of cohesion among all African countries?
Well, I just want to take the opportunity to say to the people of South Africa that Madiba's loss is our collective loss. And I had the opportunity to condole with President Jacob Zuma. Mm. I think he's been a pillar of strength in this period, right from the time he announced it till now, you know, that he's led the people of this country through this difficult period. I think that our heart goes out to not only him, but to the family of President Mandela, and indeed to all South Africans, and indeed to all Africans, mm-hmm. you know, for the loss of this great, great, great man.
Mr. President, we've seen during Mandela's administration and much after that, mediation was such a crucial part or role that South Africa played on the continent.
Yeah.
With our administration, with the current state of government at the moment in South Africa, do you think we still have that impetus to make that influential impact when it comes to mediation on the African continent?
I think that by virtue of the size of South Africa in terms of economy, politics, and development, it places a certain responsibility on South Africa in terms of leadership in Africa. In our sub-region, Nigeria, by its sheer size, population and economy, also has a certain leadership role there. And so I think that these countries have a certain responsibility to, one, ensure that Africa is conflict-free. And I think that South Africa is doing a good job so far. I mean, Central African Republic, I think South Africa's role there is commendable. And in many of the other conflicts that have taken place, in the difficult situation in Zimbabwe, South Africa has been the main interlocutor. I think that role can be expanded, and it is a responsibility that South Africa has by virtue of the kind of country that it is.
All right, I want to go back to last week, 10 minutes before 9 o'clock on Thursday, when we heard news that Mr. Mandela had passed on. Just paint for us the scenes of how Ghana actually received the news. And I speak about ordinary citizens beyond the dignitaries and beyond the high-end government officials.
I think that Mandela's death is one of those landmark events in history. Many years on, everybody would be able to remember exactly where they were and what they were doing when the news broke. I was in the air. You know, I was flying to France for the France-Africa summit. And so we got the information while we were flying. And so I was sitting in my seat and they said, oh, the Madiba has passed away. And I couldn't process it. It's been difficult, yeah. But I guess that a time comes and we must look at his life, celebrate his life, and take the legacy that he leaves us and actually not pay lip service to it, really, you know, implement what he lived for. One, that he was a principled person and was ready to die for his principles. You know, two, that He was a compassionate person, forgiven, came out of prison, not a bitter and broken person, but somebody who was prepared to lead his nation and bring the people together. And three, that he was only mortal and human, and that he played his part and left it to others to play. We should learn from that too. I mean, a lot of time, some of us think we have a divine right to rule our people, and even, you know, when it's time to go, we don't see the signs that it's time to go.
Finally, Mr. President, I've got to ask you, what you just answered to me points to the fact that Mandela, an African, had a profound effect on the people, not just on the continent, but worldwide. I mean, at no time in history have you seen this type of response, this type of tribute pour in. Why do you think that's the case? How did a man from Africa create such a type of deepening response from the entire globe?
I think that it's the nature of the person he was. It's innate in him. I mean, Mandela espouses a certain dignity, and you can't talk down on him. He lives for what he believes in. And I think that even in his relationship with world leaders, you know, his principle and his decision to die and live for what he believes in. I remember there was an incident where he was going on a visit to Libya. And I guess the Americans were not too happy about it. And they protested why he was going to Libya. It was a rogue regime. But Libya had been very helpful in the struggle against apartheid. And he said, "You don't tell me who to choose as my friends," you know, in a very dignified manner. That was the person, Mandela, and we're going to miss him.
Your Excellency, President of Ghana, John Mahama, thanks very much indeed for talking to us.
Thank you, Devon. Thank you.
We now cross to Peter Ndora at the Union Buildings.